Welcome to the Biological Life Sciences channel. Today in this video, we are going to see how the genetic code was cracked and Bobel's hypothesis. So let's begin. First of all, let's see what is the difference between DNA and RNA bases. In DNA and RNA, there are different bases present. That is, only four bases are present on RNA that can act as a genetic code. It is adenine, guanine, thymine and uracil. And in DNA there is thymine and in RNA there is uracil. So the bases that are acting as a genetic code are present in RNA only. So it is A, G, C and U. There are 20 amino acids present which are having different side chain. So all amino acids, these are in DNL form. There are two forms except the glycine amino acid. It's due to the asymmetric alpha carbon atom. So due to that, the amino acids are having two isomers DNL. So amino acids are 20. So how these 20 amino acids are coded by four base pairs only? That is the question that we are going to answer. So you can see here the distinction between non-polar, positively charged, polar, negatively charged and ambiguous amino acids, and the single letter code is given here. So when an amino acid sequence is written, then in that case, the single letter code is used for writing the sequence of amino acids. So how these four bases of DNA, that is A, U, G, C, codes for 20 amino acids, that we are going to see here. So deciphering the genetic code, the first experiment was done by Marshall Nirenberg and Heinrich Methei at NIH, USA. They cracked the genetic code first time. They were among the first to characterize specific coding sequences. So this advance was made possible due to two technologies. First is, it allowed the protein sequencing protein synthesis in vitro. Means what? All the protein synthesizing machinery is taken into test tube. That is the ribosomal subunits, that is larger and smaller ribosomal subunits, the mRNA, the GTP and all the translation factors are taken into test tube and artificial protein synthesis is done. RNA strand is synthesized first and that RNA strand is introduced into this artificial synthesizing machinery and then the translation is happening in vitro. So this technology was developed. Due to that, the two scientists were able to crack the genetic code. So let's see how they did. There are two approaches here. First is theoretical approach and second is practical approach. Theoretical approach is based on triplet hypothesis. Triplet hypothesis means they considered the genetic code as triplet. But we didn't know earlier that it is triplet. But how it can be triplet, let's see. We can see if a single code, that is single nucleotide, codes for an amino acid, then there will be only four amino acids, but in proteins actually there are 20 different amino acids are there. So it is not possible, okay? And if the codon length or a code is comprising of two nucleotides, that is two of the nitrogenous pyrimidine or purine base, then it will be maximum 16 permutations will be there. So it is also not sufficient for 20 amino acids. Okay. So if you take three nitrogenous bases, that is A, T, G, C, if you take three of them in a consecutive manner as shown it here, then only the possibility arises up to 64. Then this possibility is possible. But when you take four bases, that is A, T, G, C or A, U, G, C, four bases are taken at a time, then the possibility goes up to 256. So here theoretically scientists thought that the three codon or triplet codon hypothesis is quite possible here as it gives rise to 64 codons. So even though, so this was the possibility that they thought that the genetic codon was triplet and it coded around 64 amino acids using different permutations and combinations. So you can see here when you take the triplet and translate on ribosome, each triplet is responsible for a single amino acid. But at that time it was not confirmed practically, it was just a theoretical approach. Later on, this approach was confirmed practically by these scientists we talked about. So the question or the evidences that resulted for triplet hypothesis were, how many RNA bases specify one amino acid, that amino acid code? So there are 20 different amino acids, okay? So that can be only possible if there is a three triplet codon taken at a time, then the total reaches 64. For two it is not possible since the total or the combinations of two codons give rise to 16 different codes. Okay, so in 64 different codons, 20 amino acids are coded. This was the first evidence. And if a codon consists of only one mRNA base, then only 4 codons are possible, as we saw just now. If it is 2, then it is 16 only. So it is not enough. When it is triplet codon, then only 64 is there, and therefore it is sufficient to code for 20 amino acids. Okay, so a 4-letter code is also not possible, because it will be 256 different codons will be there. So ideally, theoretically, a triplet code is taken into consideration theoretically. Let's see the practical approach here. The cracking of genetic code, this experiment began in 1961 when Marshall Nirenberg and Heinrich Mithai, these two worked for this purpose. Okay, so their success relied on two experimental innovations, as I already told you: in vitro translational assembly, where the translation was done in vitro, the ribosomal subunits was assembled, the artificial mRNA was added into that, and then polypeptide chain was generated using all the specific requirements for translation, as happens in vivo. Okay, so they were able to produce different polypeptide chains using this artificial protein synthesis. Okay, so let's see how they did that. First of all, let's see, using this experiment here, you can see at first what they did, they took uracil nucleotides, that is precursor uracil nucleotides, and then they used they made it into poly-U homopolymer. So it's called homopolymer method. Why? Because they have synthesized mRNA which is having only U in their structure. So it's a poly-U homopolymer mRNA, you can see here. And this is done by the polynucleotide phosphorylase enzyme. Now this mRNA is added into the in vitro assembly where all different amino acids are present, and all 20 different amino acids are present, and then there are different precursors required for protein translation is taken. You can see here there are 20 different tubes in which one at a time each amino acids is radio labeled. Okay, so in the first tube, suppose first amino acids is labeled, the all remaining 19 amino acids will be unlabeled, that is radioactively labeled. Okay, so in second tube, second amino acid will be labeled, and remaining the 19 amino acids will be unlabeled. Likewise, they prepared 20 different tube or 20 different reaction sets. They incubated at 37 degrees Celsius and allowed the translation to take place. Now the protein that was synthesized was first of all precipitated and was filtered and checked for radioactivity. So the procedure was repeated in 20 different tubes, as I told you already. The radioactivity was shown only in the phenylalanine tube, as the phenylalanine or the poly-U mRNA was responsible for forming only phenylalanine polypeptide. Now this polypeptide gave rise to the this translational assembly gave rise to the polypeptide which is considering or which is having only phenylalanine in their structure. Means this, by this experiment they concluded that the codon, that is triple U, that codes for phenylalanine amino acid. Okay, similarly they used, or they did it for they prepared poly A mRNA, they prepared poly C mRNA, and they got different results. Let's see. First of all, I told you that the first experiment where poly U mRNA was used, it coded for phenylalanine. Likewise, they subsequently did this for poly A mRNA also, where only A was present. There the triplet codon of A was able to produce only lysine polypeptide, means a polypeptide having only lysine amino acid. And then third experiment, they used poly-C, and here they could get only proline as the amino acid in the polypeptide, means the polypeptide contained only proline amino acid. Okay, so by these three experiments they could crack the three amino acids here, that is the poly-U or triple-U coded for phenylalanine amino acid, then triple A coded for lysine amino acid, and triple C coded for proline amino acid. They also performed this for triple G or poly G mRNA, but this was unstable, therefore it could not be performed. Similar experiments was done using copolymer method also. You can see here synthetic mRNA of sequence AU 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 this is a copolymer, this was taken, okay. So how would the codon be here? You can see the codon will be AUA and the next codon will be UAU. These two codons will be there. So when this is translated artificially using their experiments, you get two amino acids alternatively, that is isoleucine and tyrosine. But the question is, the mRNA, which one or which of the code, that is AUA codes for isoleucine or UAU codes for isoleucine, similarly vice versa also. So to crack that, what they did, they introduced triplet codon of U, for which we know that it code for phenylalanine. Now triple U was taken and then AUA, this codon was placed. Again triple U was taken and then AUA codon was placed, and the mRNA was prepared artificially like this, okay. So now we knew that the triple U will code for phenylalanine, and then subsequently when translation happened, AUA was coding for isoleucine. So there was only isoleucine. So when in this mRNA, AUA codes for isoleucine, obviously UAU will code for tyrosine, okay. So likewise, they deduced the codon required for different amino acids, okay. So out of 60 of the possible 64 codons specified particular amino acids, okay. So there are three different codons that did not code for any amino acid, and they were stopping the translation in vitro. So these three codons were labeled as stop codons, and the starting codon was labeled as methionine, that is AUG. This means that some amino acids are specified by more than one codon. Since there are only 20 amino acids and there are 61 codons, so a single amino acid can be coded by more than one codon, okay. For example, UUU and UUC, these two codons code for phenylalanine likewise. So using this cell-free system, all 64 codons were decoded, and the codons for each and every amino acids was deduced, okay. And there were three codons that were not coding for any amino acid, and they were working as a stop codon, okay. So these are called as nonsense codon, and they act as a stop signal. Nirenberg and Khurana, along with other genetic code researcher Robert Holley, received the Nobel Prize for this discovery, that is cracking of genetic codon, and they won the Nobel Prize in 1968. So this is how you can deduce the total codon here. You can see there are different amino acids coded by different codons. There are multiple codons for single amino acids also, but there are certain amino acids that are coded by only one codon. For example, methionine, this amino acid is coded by AUG codon only. Again, another example is tryptophan, that is coded by UGG codon only. So likewise, there are two codon amino acids, three codon amino acids, even there are six codon amino acids also. So almost all the amino acids are specified by three or four different codons. Three amino acids, that is arginine, serine and leucine, are specified by six different codons. Methionine and tryptophan are encoded by single codon only, as I already told you. So likewise, here what happens, the first two, you can see in this structure or in this table, the first two codons are more important for determining which amino acid will be substituted in this translational assembly. So the third position is not that much important, okay. So even if the third position is changed, the tRNA still can recognize the particular codon. For example, you can see in this box, the first two letters are UU only, and the third letter only changes, and due to that change in third letter only, there is a change in amino acid here. So the third position is in verbal here, or third position is responsible for creating a different amino acid. So it is called as verbal, okay. So let's see what is verbal and what is verbal's hypothesis. Crick postulated, Francis Crick first time postulated verbal's hypothesis. He predicted that the initial two ribonucleotide triplets are often more critical than the third one. So the first two codons are responsible for telling you what actually codon will be, or what actually the codon will be coding for, okay. So you can see here, so if the first two codons is U, then definitely there is no two U's coming together, so definitely that amino acid will be either phenylalanine or leucine. So the tRNA which is giving or which is attaching the phenylalanine or leucine can verbal between the two. So the third base here is the verbal position. Okay. So the Crick hypothesized that the hydrogen bonding at the third position of codon anticodon interaction is less spatial and constrained. So it may also not be needed to adhere strictly to the base pairing rule. Sometimes the base pairing rule can be different also, or sometimes the third base can be a intermediate base also, such as inosinate. Okay. So 61. By the genetic code concept, there should be 61 different tRNAs for 61 different amino acids. But it is not so. There are only 49 different genes that code for tRNA. Okay. So tRNAs are limited. Okay. So some of the tRNA has to read 2 or 3 codons also. Okay. So this is because the same type of tRNA can detect the synonym code, that is verbal position, that is the third position. It can be easily detected by 2 different RNAs. Okay. So therefore here the third position is verbal here. Okay. And the total number of tRNAs is also not accurate as 61, it is only 49. So other tRNAs have to compensate this. Okay. The same type of tRNA, for example, binds to both UUU and UUC codon. You can see here that third position is uracil, here the third position is cytidine. But the thing is, the both the codons are coded by same tRNA, which specifies the amino acid phenylalanine. So thing to note here is the first two amino acid has already coded the amino acid phenylalanine. So a single amino acid, single tRNA will be required for coding of these two codons. Okay. So therefore it is called, therefore the third position is called verbal. Okay. So the synonymous code that is ending with A or G use different tRNA. So there are completely different bases there. So they use different tRNAs here. So you can see here, this is the normal base pairing, where G is paired with, always paired with C, and the first two letter is same here. So if the second letter or the third letter is U, sometimes it also pairs with G. So this is called verbal pairing, which is irrespective of the normal base pairing. Okay. But still it codes for the similar amino acid, that is leucine. So what it tells you, that the first two amino acids, or first two codons are responsible for coding the leucine amino acid, but the third position just acts as a verbal here, which can be overlooked by the tRNA, that is identical leucine tRNA. Okay. But thing is, sometimes it is not so, because if the amino acid is coding for, if the codon is AUG, then definitely it will definitely code for the amino acid methionine only. There is no role of this verbal pair here. It happens with certain codons which codes for single amino acid, means different codons coding for single amino acid. So this is, you can see here, this position with along the G there can be C or U pairing, and then the tRNA will be same here. So therefore the third position is called as verbal pair. So this is how the experiments of genetic codon happened, and the genetic code was cracked, and the verbal hypothesis was proposed here. So I hope you have understood the whole concept of cracking of genetic code, where the different code was cracked using genetic language. If you like the video, please press like button, share, comment and subscribe the channel. Thank you for watching.